Hello and welcome to this course, and in today's class we will discuss the module The Environmental Discourses. In contemporary times, discourse analysis has emerged as one of the influential methods for analyzing environmental text and debates. Discourse analysis in environmental sociology is closely associated with the social constructionist perspective which we discussed just in the last class. However, in contemporary times, discourse analysis has not remained limited only to this social constructionist approach, and it has been widely used by other environmental sociologists like political ecologists, policy analysts and critical theory. So, it is in this context that in today's class we will discuss the module Environmental Discourses. The core objective of this module is to understand the meaning and usage of discourse and discourse analysis in environmental context, and to critically discuss various discourses on environment. After successfully completing this module, students will be able to distinguish between several discourses that have emerged in recent years concerning environment and highlight the importance of discourse and discourse analysis in environmental sociology. So, the key themes of today's class are the following. Today we will basically discuss about three topics, that is the meaning and usage of discourse and discourse analysis, second, varieties of environmental discourses, and third, discourses of global environmental change and governance. So, let us begin with the first topic of today's class, that is discourses and discourse analysis. So, where basically we will focus, what do we mean by this discourse and what is discourse analysis, and what are the significance or what are the importance of this discourse analysis in environmental sociology. It will be no exaggeration to say that most of the global environmental problems are social constructions. Like we discussed in the last class, that social constructionist perspective try to argue that environmental problems are a social constructions. It is the discourse, it is the debate or discussions which convert or which transform certain empirical environmental conditions into that of an ecological crisis or an environmental problem. But when we say that environmental problems are social constructions, that does not mean to question the empirical reality of these problems. So, social construction of environmental problems not necessarily question the empirical reality of these problems, as Drejek argues. Just because something is socially interpreted or just because something is socially constructed does not mean that it is unreal. Pollution does cause illness, species do become extinct, ecosystem cannot absorb stress indefinitely, and tropical forests are disappearing. So, these are facts, but what is important is that the manner in which people make use of these realities to make sense of something. And that is where discourse analysis becomes very relevant. Discourse analysis basically points out the way in which people use language, people use text and certain ideas to portray the empirical reality. So, whether or not an empirical reality is perceived as an environmental problem depends upon the discourse which converts or which transforms that reality into that of a problem. So, our conception of environmental problem or our ideas about environmental problem necessarily emerge out of a particular discourse. So, environmental reality is portrayed into an environmental problem through discourse. Let us take two examples to understand this situation. Take this example of long queue of women and girls near the municipal tap, or the pandemonium situation when the municipal water tanker arrives near a slum. So, these realities are not social constructions, they are realities. But how one makes sense of those realities, that is important. In that sense, we can say that there are multiple constructed realities. Let us have a look at these two pictures. Perception of environmental problems depends upon the narratives in which it is discussed. If you see these two pictures that is in front of you, the long queue of water one may define as a product of water scarcity caused by limited investment in delivering water. So, this empirical reality of water scarcity or empirical reality of long queue to get water can be defined as a kind of water scarcity which is caused by limited investment to deliver water. Someone also may define this kind of problem as water shortage owing to depleting of groundwater table. So, the same picture or the same empirical reality can be analyzed or can be expressed in different ways. Somebody may conceptualize water scarcity as a limited investment because of limited investment in the water sector for which there is enough water, but it is not being extracted to deliver to the household. Somebody else may also say that no, there is a physical water scarcity. There is not enough amount of groundwater and because of which you find this kind of situation. Similarly, if you look at the problem of the pandemonium situation when a water tanker arrives near a slum. So, what can we gain from this picture? What can we understand from this picture? So, the chaos near the municipality tanker points out to the fact that water is an economic good and therefore should be rationally used. But someone else may also see, or someone else may also also understand that water is a human right and thus should be freely available to all. So, therefore, what I am trying to say that it is a language in which we depict a particular empirical reality. It is a language or the text in which we depict a particular empirical reality or particular environmental reality that is important than the reality itself. Because the reality is expressed with the help of certain language. The reality is expressed with certain text and with certain kind of narration. So, it is these narratives, it is these texts or the languages that becomes important for a discourse analysis. And what does these examples narrate or what does these examples portray? These examples that I just showed, they portray the role of language in constructing the reality. As I just told, that reality is expressed with a particular language. Reality is depicted with the help of a language. And these pictures emphasize the role of language in depicting the reality. Role of language not only depicting the reality but also constructing the reality. Because language here is not just a medium to describe a reality, but also an instrument to construct alternate realities. In that sense, there are multiple realities and different kind of languages, different kind of texts are used to signify, to describe the same empirical reality. In that sense, we may find a difference between language as it was used in the positivist framework in social science and in the post-positivist framework. In positivist framework, language has an hegemonic domination because language is used to describe the reality, whereas in post-positivist framework, language is used to construct a reality. In that sense, it is wrong to say that there is one reality, there are multiple realities and different types of language are used to portray the multiple reality. But however, the reality may be the same, but it may be explained in different kinds of language. So, in that sense, language plays an important role in the meaning making process. Language is used in a narrative to construct certain meaning systems. So, in that sense, it is the language, it is the discourse or it is the debate which uses a particular kind of language that becomes important in understanding empirical realities of nature. And discourse approach or discourse analysis approach basically tries to say this thing, that it is the language in which we describe an empirical reality of nature that is more important than the empirical reality itself. So, let us understand what is discourse and what is discourse analysis. Discourse analysis may be pointed out or may be identified as analysis of discursive constructions of social world through skillful use of language. So, we use specific language, a particular type of language to construct a reality about the social world or to construct a social reality. So, it helps in assessing public policy by extending new tools to examine how certain perspectives are constructed or how certain perspectives are structured, produced and emerge as dominant. So, discourse analysis basically tries to find out that how certain realities become dominant, how certain environmental realities become dominant, and it tries to examine the language with which those dominant realities are portrayed. It also points out that examination of discourses raise pertinent questions about the reality. So, discourse analysis, instead of accepting the reality uncritically, or in other words, instead of accepting the realities as it is, it tries to ask a question, what produced the reality? Who is responsible for the reality and what can be or what should be done for the reality. So, in that sense, environmental discourse analysis, instead of accepting environmental facts uncritically or instead of accepting environmental facts as it lies out there, it raises certain pertinent questions that how that reality has become the dominant reality. Who is responsible for that kind of reality? So, there are different uses of this discourse analysis in environmental sociology. So, a study of discourse will help to understand not just language. Even though I say that discourse is the use of language to express certain ideas about an empirical reality, but the study of discourse is more than understanding the language. It is help us, the study of discourse helps us in understanding not just language, but more importantly, the underlying power relations which produce and popularize these discourses. In other words, that behind every discourse, there is a power relationship. And this language is used to express that power, or language is used to express that power relationship. So, the positional advantages from which these discourses come from. So, discourse analysis also helps to understand that who is expressing this language, what is the positional advantages of those who express a reality in a particular language, and what are the counterpositions to that kind of expression. So, in other words, discourse analysis basically tries to find out alternate descriptions of the reality, alternate depictions of the reality. Like Michael Billig points out that to understand the meaning of a discourse, one should not examine the words within the discourse. Language is important, but discourse analysis is not limited to the language. So, to continue again the quotation from Michael Billig, that to understand the meaning of a discourse, one should not examine the words within a discourse. One should also consider the positions which are being criticized or against which justification is being mounted. Without knowing these positions or the counterpositions, the argumentative meaning will be lost in a discourse analysis. In other words, discourse analysis is not just use of language, but we need to understand from which vantage point that language comes from, who is expressing that language, who is expressing the environmental reality. So, that becomes important in discourse analysis. So, let us understand what is this discourse, how can we define discourse and how can we define environmental discourse. In everyday use, we interchangeably use the word discourse with that of debate or with our discussion, or it is, in other words, a sum of communicative interactions. So, discourse basically means it is a combination of different kind of modes with which we express ourselves. It can be the language, it can be the text, it can be communication, it can be the speech, it can be also different literature, it can be also different text. So, in other words, discourse is the combination of conversations, speeches, articles, statements about ideas, concepts and categories of any social phenomenon that can be regarded as discourse. And we use these materials to make sense about that social phenomenon. To define discourse, Martin Heidegger has defined discourse as an ensemble of ideas, concepts and categories through which meaning is given to social and physical phenomenon, and which is produced and reproduced through an identifiable set of practices. In other words, discourse basically means it is a collection of ideas which is expressed through a particular language. It is a collection of ideas, concepts and categories through which we make certain meaning about a phenomenon, and these concepts, categories and ideas are expressed with the help of a language. That is why language becomes important in a discourse analysis. In social science, over the years, 5 different categories of discourse analysis have emerged, like conversation analysis, sociolinguistic analysis, discursive psychology, critical discourse analysis and Foucauldian analysis. Conversation analysis is basically used in humanities, where we make sense of communications. When, let us say, 2 friends are talking, or two individuals are talking with each other. So, we make sense, or we create certain meaning out of those conversations. Similarly, sociolinguistic basically tries to understand the importance of social factors in language, how certain social factors are expressed with the help of language. But in environmental sociology, the 2 most dominating discourse analysis approaches has been that of the critical discourse analysis and the Foucauldian discourse analysis. Critical discourse analysis basically tries to understand the role of power in discourse analysis, how certain discourse analysis produces certain, how certain discourse analysis is produced because of a power relationship. So, critical discourse analysis focuses on social power in production of these discourses and studies the way in which ideology, identity and inequalities are enacted and reenacted through text produced in social and political context. In other words, discourse analysis or critical discourse analysis tries to point out that when we analyze an empirical phenomenon, or when we analyze an environmental phenomenon, we should understand the language, and we should also understand the power play that is behind that language. That when a particular language is used to express a discourse or to build a narrative, there is a power play which exists out there. And our expression of environment or our expression of nature is a reflection of the existing power play in society, the existing power inequalities or power hierarchies in society. So therefore, the dominant perspectives of endowment always comes from the vantage point of the powerful. So there is a power play, and in building the discourse or in creating the discourse, and critical discourse analysis tries to understand this power play behind the discourse analysis. Likewise, the Foucauldian discourse analysis tries to see the problem from a different context. The Foucauldian discourse analysis focuses on the role of discourse and structure in producing and reproducing power relations in society. So it is not that discourse is a reflection of power, or discourse is a reflection of the existing power hierarchies or power inequalities, but discourse itself produces another kind of power. That power is exercised in society with the help of discourse. A particular discourses are used to exercise certain kind of power. And Foucauldian discourse analysis also suggests that rather than examining the truth of any policy context, or rather than examining the truth of any environmental policy, we should examine how, why, and by whom truth is attributed to a particular argument in a policy context and not the other. In other words, we should begin with a premise that there is no one truth about an environmental discourse. Environmental discourse are portrayed or are depicted in multiple narratives, but out of these multiple narratives, one particular narrative becomes important, one particular narrative becomes dominant. And as sociologists, we should understand why a particular narrative becomes dominant in expressing environmental reality and not the other. How a particular environmental reality becomes dominant because of the existing power relationship. So it is the power or the unequal exercise of power, and that becomes important in discourse analysis. And Foucauldian discourse analysis also spells out that discourse itself produces certain kind of power. If you go back to the example with which you began our class, the discourses of water scarcity. The water scarcity can be depicted, as I told, from different kinds of perspectives. Water scarcity can be conceptualized as lack of investment for which people are not having access to water because there is enough amount of water, and what is required is right kind of intervention. What is required is more and more investment so that water can be extracted and delivered to the people. Another discourse may say that no, water scarcity is a physical scarcity. Even if you do investment, or even if you increase your investment, that will not solve the water scarcity because it is a physical scarcity. There is physical scarcity of water. So these two discourses are completely different, but they try to portray or they try to explain the same empirical reality of shortage of water or the problem of water. So therefore, what Foucauldian discourse analysis says that what we need to understand that how certain reality becomes dominant, how certain depiction of the reality becomes dominant, why in a particular kind of environmental policy, one perspective or one phenomenon becomes dominant and not the other. And Foucauldian discourse analysis has been used by Martin Heidegger to understand policy changes and ecological modernization in the Western European context. Especially Martin Heidegger uses Foucauldian discourse analysis to understand environmental policy changes in Britain and Netherlands. And according to Martin Heidegger, environmental policy making is neither a rational scientific process nor a rational deliberative process. Environmental policy making is a field of power struggle, where it is a field of power struggle between different interests, where knowledge and truth are contested. So instead of arguing or instead of accepting that there is only one reality and with which we should go ahead, or we should accept uncritically, Foucauldian discourse analysis basically accepts or basically begins with the premise that there are multiple realities, there are multiple constructs of realities, and environmental policy making it is a field where knowledge and truth are contested. So therefore, to summarize this first part of my lecture, what I'm trying to say that in the recent times, discourse and discourse analysis has emerged as an important tool to understand environmental policy making. That discourses, as we discussed, discourses are basically a combination of ideas, combination of concepts and categories which are expressed with the help of a particular language. And critical discourse analysis basically tries to understand the power relationship behind these depiction of certain environmental realities. That why a particular reality is depicted in a particular manner, that implies that there is certain kind of power play, or there is certain kind of power involved in that. So therefore, critical discourse analysis basically tries to understand environmental policy making or environmental ideas, taking into account the existing inequalities, the existing power hierarchies within the society. So, discourse analysis therefore has emerged as an important tool to understand our ideas about the nature. Our ideas, how do we construct knowledge about nature? How do we construct knowledge about relationship of human society with that of nature?